So that's the goal this morning, is to recognize and come and see, so to speak, what God has done. Men are important. How men live is important. How men lead their family is important. On January 21st, I would invite men and young men as well to come and discover more about what it means to be a Christian man, a biblical view of masculinity. Just want to encourage you to be there. We'll look in Scripture and we'll be talking about the battles we face in life and how do we meet those battles and win with God's help from a biblical point of view. Luke chapter 1, we're going to have a few goals here this morning. We're going to eventually get to Luke chapter 1, verse 46 through 55. That is the Song of Mary. That's the first Christmas song that was ever sang. It's the Magnificat. We'll talk about this utterance of praise back to God at the news that she, Mary, would be carrying the baby Jesus. And then after that, we want to discuss some theological implications of that truth. What does that mean for me and you here today? But first, before we can fully appreciate Mary's point of view, we need to consider what it really meant in the grand biblical narrative from a first century Jewish version's point of view. What this meant for the nation of Israel, even what it meant for humanity. So I'd like to spend just a few minutes summarizing Old Testament history, getting us in the mindset of this news. Now, often it's the temptation of a preacher at Easter or Christmas to overpreach, when simply the truth that is declared and stated by the Word of God is enough. So we're going to read together as a family, here together, Luke chapter 1, verses 1 through 55. And then we'll make a few notes there at the end. So let's pray and pray that the Lord will add His blessing. Lord, I need You here this morning. Lord, I'm simply a broken man standing here, Lord, desiring to proclaim Your Word and to lift up Jesus. God, I pray You'd help me do that. I pray You'd help us all open our ears and open our hearts to this truth. Lord, that it wouldn't be just another discussion about Christmas, but that it would be a proclamation and recognition of what You have done. God, I pray in the midst of this busy season that we would be able to appreciate afresh and anew what it meant that Jesus would humble Himself and take on flesh and be like us. I pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. So look, at the beginning, God created everything, right? From nothing. He created man. And then we know there in the Garden of Eden, Adam and Eve fell. They sinned. Then they were put out from the Garden of Eden and they went to do the repopulation of the planet. Time passed by and man grew very wicked. And then God raised up a man in Noah to build an ark so that God could preserve humanity. And then God flooded the earth as punishment and judgment for sin. God issued a promise that He would never do it again, but then He judged the earth. Man again grew wicked, congregated around a tower trying to reach the heavens. God confounded their speech, and then man went from there. Time passed, and God called out Abraham and issued a covenant promise to Abraham, saying, Abraham, come and go to a land that I will lead you to. It'll be that promised land. I will make you a great nation, and through your seed, everyone, all humanity, would be blessed. We know Abraham and Sarah's struggle of birthing a young man, but eventually Isaac was born, and this same covenant was issued to him. Then Isaac had two sons, Jacob and Esau, and God saw fit to continue that covenant promise through Jacob. Jacob's name would be changed to Israel. Jacob would birth 12 sons. These young men would be the heads, the leaders, the patriarchs of the 12 tribes of Israel that would eventually become a nation. But before that, God would lead this family of 70 people down to Egypt, where they would be preserved and they would prosper for a time, but this family would grow to be millions, some scholars assert. And they became a threat to Pharaoh and his rule, and we know what happened from there, right? They were oppressed. They sought God's help, and through an exciting, interesting, fascinating series of events, Moses goes back. God shows his power through 10 plagues, and finally the nation of Israel is allowed to leave. Not allowed to leave. They were led by God out of Egypt, right? God gave Moses, this leader, his law, instructing, "You will be set apart as holy as my people. This is how you are to worship me." God issued a civil law, how they should treat one another, a ceremonial law, how they should worship God, but also a moral law, that if obeyed, the nations around them would look at them and say, "Surely this is the people of God." And God permitted a way through temple worship that Gentiles could come and worship the one true Jehovah. God's plan was that Moses would lead this nation to conquer the promised land. But through disobedience, God would not allow him and his generation to do that. God raised up Joshua to lead this military campaign to take over this land. God gave specific instructions. Often they obeyed. Sometimes perhaps they fell short, but nonetheless they had victory with the help of God. They crossed the Jordan, and for 7 years they conquered the land. And then, as God had promised many centuries before, he allowed them to settle there in Canaan, this promised land. They divided the land among 11 tribes, and then one tribe was set apart to be ministers, to be priests, all throughout the cities. Those were the Levites. God was their king. God was their leader. But oftentimes, as we all do, the nation of Israel repeated many cycles of sin. They would then be conquered by invading peoples. Oftentimes, they would be held in bondage. God would raise up judges, they were called, to lead in delivering them, and then God would return his blessing upon their obedience. This time spans about 300 to 400 years in the nation of Israel's history. Famous judges like Ehud, Jephthah, Gideon, Samson, my favorite, right? Even Deborah, a lady, was leading at that time. The oppressors were invaders, but they could not succeed. Finally, the people desired so bad to have a king. So God raised up the first of the great prophets, Samuel. And Samuel anointed Saul as king. Saul was a goodly man, one worthy to be followed. But he sinned and fell, and God rejected him as king of Israel and raised up another that would follow after God's own heart, David. David ushered in what could be considered the golden age of Israel. Boundaries were expanded. God was honored. The people were obedient. David desired to build the temple. God wouldn't allow him because he was a man of war. So David made preparations that Solomon, his son, would become king and build this grand temple. And grand it was. Solomon was famous in all the world for his riches and also for his wisdom. 120 years of prosperity passed through the reigns of Saul, David, and Solomon. And then this nation, God's promised nation, this people were divided. They experienced civil war by the poor leadership of Solomon's son, Rehoboam. 10 tribes went to the north, and they became the northern nation, kingdom of Israel. 2 tribes stayed in the south, and they became the southern kingdom of Judah. God raised up prophets like Isaiah and Jeremiah, challenging the people to be obedient to God. But eventually, because of the leadership of many wicked kings and their inability to hear and heed God's warning, God enacted punishment on the northern tribe. They fell in the year 722 BC at the hands of the Assyrians, as prophesied by the prophets would happen if they did not turn and repent. Now in the southern kingdom, somewhat of a revival happened. Of 20 some odd kings, 8 were godly men, so God preserved them. But eventually their wickedness, in spite of the prophets God sent, grew to be so great that God caused them to be conquered by the Babylonians in 586, carried away into captivity. Now here, as was foretold in Genesis, that God would bring redemption to all, pictured throughout Scripture that there would be a Messiah, these prophets specifically begin to speak about the coming Messiah. Prophecies from Isaiah there in chapter 7, even saying that he would come and he would be born of a virgin. There in Isaiah 53, explaining what his ministry would be, his suffering, his death, that he would bear the sins of many. So the people that were interested in following God and looking at his word began to pointedly look for this Messiah. Now think about it. The great patriarchs that we discussed were not the Messiah. Those wonderful leaders like Moses and Joshua, they were not the Messiah, right? Those judges still fell short. Even kings were not the Messiah. They desired to see God come, send his Messiah, and rescue these people. After the destruction experienced through the Assyrians and the Babylonians, God allowed men to go back and rebuild the temple of Zerubbabel, the second temple, reinstate his law, rebuild the walls around the city, Ezra and Nehemiah. We talked about that weeks ago. And then these prophets, Malachi, for example, is the last prophet recorded there in the Old Testament, urging the people to be obedient to God now that they had been left to return home. But get it, they were a broken people, a weak people, a people that had a temple, but it wasn't like the temple before. They had a city, but it was not nearly as glorious as the city of David. So this is where they're at. And then there's a 300 or 400 year period between the close of God speaking in the Old Testament until the news that Jesus, the Messiah, would be coming, the beginning or the start of the New Testament. But during that time, a lot of fascinating things happened. The Pharisees and the Sadducees arose to power. The religious leaders of the nation of Israel became entangled with the leaders of the Roman Empire. Because we know Alexander the Great spread the Roman Empire throughout the known world, encompassing Judah and Israel. And so they were under now huge authority, huge oppression, unlike they had experienced before. They had a form of religion being imposed on them of the Pharisees and the Sadducees. They had a temple, but man, they were broken, looking for this Messiah, reflecting on the history I just told you, knowing well the promise that God made to Abraham and continued through Isaac and Jacob, understanding what it meant to be God's people, a sovereign people in the land of Canaan, worshiping God. But now all of that's gone. Experiencing continually God's revelation to these people through judges and prophets and kings. Now 400 years of silence. So that's where we're at now as we begin to look at Luke chapter 1. I would ask you to look on the screen, but even open your copy of God's Word. We're simply going to read this narrative story, this true historical event of the good news of Jesus coming being revealed to Mary. I would say this though, that's not just good news back then. It's good news for us today. And that's what we'll conclude with this morning. These deep theological truths, foundations to Christianity that we get the benefit of because of this good news. And so, that's why the title of the sermon is Merry Christmas. Man, what a Merry Christmas we get to celebrate this year. Sure, we're busy. We have to endure some family members at times. Can I get an amen there? You know, we all have to eat Aunt Susie's pink stuff that she brings every year. We're not sure what it is, but we don't want to hurt her feelings. So we smile at the gift of the gray socks that you get as a 10-year-old, and you were really hoping it was a hand grenade or a BB gun. But that's Christmas, right? That's okay. But in the midst of all that, there's still this good, good truth here. So if you would, man, let's just read this story as a church family. Luke chapter 1, verse 1. He opens. Inasmuch as many have undertaken to compile a narrative of the things that have been accomplished among us, just as those who from the beginning were eyewitnesses and ministers of the word have delivered them to us. Luke's saying this has already been done, but I'm going to take a shot at it. Verse 3, it seemed good to me also, having followed all things closely for some time past, to write an orderly account for you, most excellent Theophilus, that you may have certainty concerning the things that you have been taught. I can't do any better than Luke, so let's just read Luke's words. He says, verse 5, in the days of Herod, king of Judea, there was a priest named Zechariah of the division of Abijah. And he had a wife from the daughters of Aaron, and her name was Elizabeth. And they were both righteous before God, walking blamelessly in all the commandments and statutes of the Lord. Oh, that could be said about me. Verse 7, but they had no child because Elizabeth was barren and both were advanced in years. Verse 8, now, while he was serving as priest before God when his division was on duty, according to the custom of the priesthood, he was chosen by lot to enter the temple of the Lord and burn incense. And the whole multitude of the people were praying outside at the hour of incense. And there appeared to him an angel of the Lord standing on the right side of the altar of incense. And Zechariah was troubled when he saw him, and fear fell upon him. But the angel said unto him, do not be afraid, Zechariah, for your prayer has been heard, and your wife Elizabeth will bear you a son, and you shall name him John. This would be John the Baptist. Verse 14. And you will have joy and gladness, and many will rejoice at his birth. I'd like to just mention real quick, man, the idea that children stand before us and sing praises unto God, that brings me joy and gladness. Isn't that good? Verse 15. For he will be great before the Lord, and he must not drink wine or strong drink, and he will be filled with the Holy Spirit, even from his mother's womb, the angel says. Verse 16, and he will turn many of the children of Israel to the Lord their God, and he will go before him in the spirit and power of Elijah to turn the hearts of the fathers to the children, and the disobedient to the wisdom of the just, to make ready for the Lord a people prepared. Verse 18, and Zechariah said unto the angel, how shall I know this? For I am an old man, and my wife is advanced in years. And the angel answered him, I am Gabriel. I stand in the presence of God, and I was sent to speak to you and to bring you this good news. And behold, you will be silent and unable to speak until the day that these things take place, because you did not believe my words, which will be fulfilled in their time. Now, we all probably would struggle believing those words. Zechariah did, and he was made silent because of it. Verse 21, and the people were waiting for Zechariah, and they were wondering at his delay in the temple. And when he came out, he was unable to speak to them, and they realized that he had seen a vision in the temple. It had been a long time since that happened. A long time before a priest had this kind of experience, before a prophetic word from God had been sent. And they realized, whoa, something is different here. And he kept making signs to them and remained mute. And when his time of service was ended, he went to his home. After these days, his wife Elizabeth conceived, and for 5 months she kept herself hidden, saying, "Thus the Lord has done for me in the days when he looked on me to take away my reproach among the people." As we know, in those days, it was somewhat of a negative characteristic for a lady not to be able to bear a son. Verse 26. In the sixth month, the angel of Gabriel was sent from God to a city of Galilee named Nazareth, to a virgin betrothed to a man whose name was Joseph, and the house of David. Remember David from history? And the virgin's name was Mary. Verse 28. And he came to her and said, "Greetings, O favored one, the Lord is with you." But she was greatly troubled at the saying and tried to discern what sort of greeting this might be. And the angel said unto her, "Do not be afraid, Mary, for you have found favor with God. And behold, you will conceive in your womb and bear a son, and you shall call his name Jesus. He will be great and will be called the Son of the Most High. And the Lord will give to him the throne of his father David. And he will reign over the house of Jacob forever, and of his kingdom there will be no end." Considering the historical backdrop, the knowledge of a Jew, man, this is huge. This is huge. Verse 34, "And Mary said unto the angel, How will this be, since I am a young virgin? And the angel answered her, The Holy Spirit will come upon you, and the power of the Most High will overshadow you. Therefore, the child to be born will be called holy, the Son of God. And behold, your relative Elizabeth in her old age has also conceived a son. And this is the sixth month with her who was called barren. For nothing will be impossible with God." And Mary said, "Behold, I am the servant of the Lord. Let it be to me according to your word." And the angel departed from her. So guess what Mary does? Verse 39. "In those days Mary arose and went with haste into the hill country to the town of Judah. And she entered the house of Zechariah and greeted Elizabeth. And when Elizabeth heard the greeting of Mary, the baby in her womb, and Elizabeth was filled with the Holy Spirit. And she exclaimed with a loud cry, 'Blessed are you among women, and blessed is the fruit of your womb. And why is this granted to me, that the mother of my Lord should come to me?'" The Holy Spirit revealed in this moment to Elizabeth that Mary was carrying the Son of God, or would be the mother of the Son of God. "For behold, when the sound of your greeting came to my ears, the baby in my womb leaped for joy. And blessed is she who believed that there would be a fulfillment of what was spoken to her from the Lord." Boy, isn't that neat? That God revealed this truth to Elizabeth, Zechariah, and Mary? That the Messiah was coming? Now here we go. Mary's Psalm of Praise. The first Christmas song. The Magnificat. To summarize, Mary replied with prophetic words of her own. I want you to notice this as we read it. This is known as the Magnificat, because this is a Latin word that means it's the first words of Mary's outpouring of praise. It's really a song, it's a hymn about the incarnation of God into flesh. It's filled with joy and praise. It's equal to any other psalm, I would argue. Get it? It's filled with messianic hope. That's what we're going to read. The hope that the people long for. In the grand biblical narrative, it was the hope that God had in mind the whole time. From Genesis there, when he promised that Satan would be conquered. So here we go. Luke 1, verse 41 through 55. Verse 46. And Mary said, "My soul magnifies the Lord, and my spirit rejoices in God my Savior." Notice the personal statement. "For he looked on the humble estate of his servant, for behold, from now on all generations will call me blessed. For he who is mighty has done great things for me, and holy is his name." Now we may not be among the ranks of Mary, but friend, look, God has done great things for me and you. And I would hope that our hearts would respond in this same manner. Verse 50, "And his mercy is for those who fear him from generation to generation." That's that messianic hope. That's that hope for me and you. Verse 51, "He has shown strength with his arm. He has scattered the proud in the thoughts of their hearts. And he has brought down the mighty from their thrones and exalted those of humble estate." It is my view that this is alluding to God's preventative measure, so to speak, that rulers would be able to rule in Israel. The next ruler would be Jesus and Jesus alone. Verse 53, "He has filled the hungry with good things, and the rich he has sent away empty. He has helped his servant Israel, and in remembrance of his mercy, as he spoke to our fathers, to Abraham and to his offspring forever." Do you see the fulfillment? This is the climax, the conclusion of what the Old Testament had been pointing to all along. And how could Mary respond in any other way? Jesus, the Son of God, would now be birthed. He would become a man. God himself would be incarnated. But now it's just not enough to stop there. What I want to conclude with briefly are just a few ways this matters to me and you. Why we can anchor our hope here also. Why we can look back and respond the way Mary did. First of all, Jesus had to come and be a man for representative obedience. Now what that means is this. Jesus obeyed for us where Adam had failed. Romans 5, verse 18 and 19. Listen to Paul's words. "Therefore, as one trespass led to condemnation for all men, we're all sinners because of the sin of Adam. His sin is inherited by us." That's what he's saying there. "One trespass led to the condemnation for all men, so one act of righteousness leads to justification and life for all men. For as by one man's disobedience the many were made sinners, and by the one man's obedience the many will be made righteous." God himself came and fully obeyed in flesh so that his work could declare us righteous, so that he could atone for your sin and for my sin. Secondly, Jesus came and wore flesh so that he could sympathize with us as our high priest, and also so that he, this sinless man, could be a substitute sacrifice on the cross. Look, if Jesus had not been a man, he could not have died in our place and paid the penalty, the sin penalty that you and I need to pay. We would be left without a Savior. If Jesus had not been a man, he would not have been able to know by human experience what you and I go through, to understand in a real way our temptations and struggles. But friend, we do have a substitute sacrifice paid in our stead, and we do have a high priest that can bear our burdens. Hebrews chapter 2, verses 14 through 18 highlight both of these truths. Verse 14, since therefore the children share in flesh and blood, he himself likewise, this is speaking of Jesus, partook of the same things, that through death he might destroy the one who has the power of death, that is, the devil, and deliver those who through fear of death were subject to lifelong slavery. Here it is. Verse 16, for surely it is not angels that he helps, speaking of Jesus, but he helps the offspring of Abraham. That's me and you. Therefore, Jesus, therefore he had to be made like his brothers in every aspect, in every respect, so that he might become a merciful and faithful high priest in the service of God to make propitiation for the sins of the people. That word means he died in our place. He paid our sin debt. Verse 18, I'm going to conclude on this point. For because he himself suffered when he tempted, because Jesus suffered when he was tempted, he is able to help those who are being tempted. Doesn't that make sense? Jesus came and walked like we do. Next, Jesus needed to come and live in the flesh so that he could be our mediator, this go-between for us, that he would defend and argue for us in heaven before God. Because we are alienated from God, we need this go-between. Because our sin separates us from God, we need this mediator. 1 Timothy 2, 5 through 7. For there is one God, and there is one mediator between God and men. Old Testament prophets weren't fit. There's one true mediator between God and man. The man, Christ Jesus, who gave himself as a ransom for all, which is the testimony given at the proper time. Isn't that good? We do have a high priest in heaven ministering on our behalf. That is this. When we struggle and make a mistake and sin, God stands and Jesus stands there and mediates so that, as Paul put it in Romans, there is no condemnation for those that are in Christ. Jesus, hold on, I paid the sin debt. Satan has no accusations against my children. Let me remind you, Jesus would say, my sacrifice paid it for all. My sheep will not be cast away. No one can remove them from my hand. God has given them to me and I will lose none. Our salvation is sure because we have this mediator. We have this high priest. We have this one that paid our sin debt for us. We have this messianic hope. Merry Christmas. This is good news. Man, I'm thankful for Jesus, aren't you? I would have no hope apart from Jesus. Praise be unto God. Jesus came and lived as man to be our example and pattern in life. Jesus had to be a man like us to live as our example. Jesus is the perfecter and founder of our faith. Hebrews chapter 12, verses 1 and 2. This is right after Paul talked. Paul does this brilliant exposition of all of the heroes of our faith. I mean, he holds these guys and ladies up to just an ultimate praise. And then this is what he follows with. Therefore, since we are surrounded by all of this great cloud of witness that he just told us about, let us also, like them, lay aside every weight and sin which clings us so closely. And let us run this race with endurance, this race that's set before us. And then he says this, looking to Jesus. Let's run this race looking to Jesus, the founder and perfecter of our faith, who for the joy that was set before him endured the cross, despising the shame, and is seated at the right hand of the throne of God. Man, isn't that good? 1 Peter chapter 2, verse 21, concerning suffering and struggling, he said this, "For to this you have been called, because Christ also suffered for you, leaving you an example so that you might follow in his footsteps. God's plan is that we would follow fully and completely Jesus. He is the one qualified to be followed. He gives us this example. He is God revealed to us. Concluding. Now this one's good. I like this. If you have your scriptures there, you might turn over to 1 Corinthians chapter 15. I'd put a big box around this one. Man, this is our enduring hope. This is good. Jesus is the pattern of our future redeemed bodies. Now we have physical bodies like Adam, but we will have one like Jesus. 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verses 16 through 27. Paul's going to be discussing, he's arguing for the truth that there is going to be a resurrection. And he's arguing in light, he's claiming Jesus was resurrected. You'll hear him say things like, if there is no resurrection, then this faith of ours is pointless, right? Then that means Jesus was not resurrected. But know this, if there is a resurrection, and there will be, then Jesus was resurrected. So let's hear these words. 1 Corinthians 15, verses 16 through 27. For if the dead are not raised, not even Christ has been raised. And if Christ has not been raised, your faith is futile and you are still in your sins, he says. Then those also who have fallen asleep or have died in Christ, then they're eternally perished. If there's no resurrection, you're still in your sins, and everybody that's dead is just dead, right? If in Christ we have hope in this life only, we are of all people most pitied. Paul's saying, look, this hope in Christ is more than just for this kind of life. We have a future hope, and that, now he's going to get into it. Verse 20, but in fact, Christ has been raised from the dead. Get it? He's the first fruits of those who have fallen asleep. Now, this is an agricultural term, this idea of Jesus being the first fruits. What would happen, as soon as the first fruit of a harvest is evidenced, you go out and you pick it, and then you know this is the pattern of the full harvest. Man, this is a really good apple. This is going to be a great apple harvest. Or the negative might be true also. In this case, Paul is saying that about Jesus. He was the first fruits of the resurrection. Jesus was the first fruits of anyone that had died. Get it. He continues. Verse 21. For as by a man came death, that is that Adamic death, that is the death of Adam, and by a man come also the resurrection of the dead. For as in Adam all die, so also in Christ shall all be made alive. But each in his own order, because Christ the first fruits, then at his coming those who belong to Christ. Jesus has been resurrected. Jesus is in heaven. And that's the pattern we look forward to. You and I, if we are in Christ, we will be resurrected. We will be taken to heaven. Jesus conquers all. In summary, look, Mary, she had hope, good hope, godly hope, a relevant hope. But friend, you and I do too. We should utter praises of adoration and glory and worship to God. Because you know why? That's why. Let's look at it. Jesus represented fully what God wanted him to do so that he could be a suitable, adequate, substitutionary sacrifice for you and me. He can now sympathize with us as high priest. He is now our mediator between us and God when we struggle. Jesus is our example, and Jesus is the pattern for our resurrection. In him, we have hope. Would you stand with me, Pastor Ryan? Friend, I'm going to state it simply. If Jesus is not this to you, man, let's repent. Let's put our faith fully and squarely in Jesus and in Him alone. And if you'd like to do that, I'll meet you down front to pray with you.